Yeah, we can start now.
Good morning. I welcome everyone to our talk by Professor Muralidharan about the influence of science and how its knowledge is translated into various products that we come across in our daily life. Professor Muralidharan completed his master's degree in applied chemistry from Anna University, Tamil Nadu in 1997. He completed his PhD in 2003 from IIT Kanpur. He is currently working as a professor in School of Chemistry, University of Hyderabad. His research interest is focused on the synthesis and application of nanoparticles, small molecules and polymer from p-block elements for potential application in the field of health, energy and environment. His publications include nanoparticles, photoresponsive materials, synthesis and catalysis, polymer, optical materials and many more. If there are any questions during the talk, kindly drop it in the chat box and they will be addressed at the end. Now I would like to invite our honorable speaker, Professor Muralidharan, to continue.
Thanks, Marasita, for your introduction. And I also thank the entire students team for organizing this thing and also inviting me to give a talk here. And it's a very pleasure to talk to you all, especially first year IMSC students, mainly, right? Though I have done a couple of lab or theory classes to you, this is something which I want to convey to almost all everyone who is in science field. Okay, so coming to this topic, all of us had this question in our mind, right? Should I be a scientist or engineer or a medical doctor? Especially important thing, when you are in the 11th or 12th class, everybody is going to ask you, in South India, this is very, very common. Are you going to be an engineer? Are you going to be a doctor? Okay, so nobody asks you, are you going to be a scientist? So that is sometime I also personally felt that it's hurting somebody's interest sometime. Okay, rarely people say that I'm going for commerce and this thing, but very few people prefer to say science. The reason is that generally the society, many people, they think that who are all scoring high mark, they go to medical stream. And next in the ranking, they go to engineering stream. And only who are not able to get into medical or engineering, they are going to science stream. Though it is partially true, but it's not always necessarily be. Okay. So that is what I want to convey to all of you, that you have already chosen to join in science stream. And nothing wrong in that one. And you can do very well and to the society or even for your career. Okay, that is supposed to be the focus of this talk today. I can convey this thing by saying that how chemistry is understandable and how it is transferred to the interesting applied material. Generally, when you go to chemistry class in 11th class or 12th class, right? So your teachers will keep writing like this thing. Many things written in the board, right? Many reactions, many compound structure, all these things. So almost in the initial days, this is our feeling, right? So I don't understand anything. What is that he or she is talking? And what is the use of this, reading all these chemicals or the reactions or chemistry, right? So to get rid of this feeling, what I would suggest you is that we should try to understand the chemistry in such a way that how it is really going to be useful for our day-to-day life. So what I'm going to tell you today is that I'll take 3-4 examples from the 11th, 12th class textbook. I have taken some just photocopy from the or scan copy from CBSE book, sorry, NCERT book. Okay, but if you understand the chemistry is really colorful science, right? Colorful subject, and you can really love the subject. So let us look at this picture. This you can take from any Google site, right? A Google search, and you see that it's called, it's known as a polar bear. Very, beautiful animal, normally lives in North and South Polar, where you have so much of snow, only ice, right? And some few years back, there was a picture about the same polar bear. You see how it was so beautiful, and many of them are gone like this, right? So, and in fact, this picture got the best picture award in all over world, basically because, not because of that, how he has taken, but basically because how, what the message this photo is conveying to the people. So based on that, it was given world best photo award also, right? The message what it conveys is that, this one. So all of us know change of climate, and this change of climate is influenced by many issues what we are doing in the earth, right? So, and change of climate again affecting the for example, the corals in the sea, which is really controlling the oxygen and carbon dioxide level in the atmosphere, raising sea level, and warm water kills many of the sea animals, right? And stronger storm, acid rain, sometimes change in the pattern of the snow, rain, and forest fire in some places. So all these things, so these are all very well known. You would have seen many news about this in various magazines or in newspaper or something like that, and even science literature also. So one of the main reason is that, you know, global warming is created by carbon dioxide now. So carbon dioxide is needed in the atmosphere, which is creating the greenhouse effect, all this thing you know very well, right? But too much of carbon dioxide is no problematic because it is not allowing the heat to go back out of the atmosphere, right? Global warming is what is, sunlight is falling onto the earth, and it is reflected back. When it is reflected back, something is retained because of carbon dioxide atmosphere and ozone layer also. This is all killing the carbon dioxide, and ozone layer play important role in the greenhouse effect. I don't want to go detail into that one. So when we have this problem of global warming and carbon dioxide level or pollution level in the atmosphere, if you ask any engineer, right? If you ask any engineer, the engineer will come and tell to the leaders of the world, how can we control this problem? Everybody knows that. Everybody will tell that, no, you use install solar panel, and then we should minimize the effect of the fossil fuel so that the global warming can be controlled. So industrial purpose or automobile purpose, everywhere you install the solar cell and electricity-based solar cell. Right, that is the common solution given by an engineer. Okay, so you know what is solar cell. It's a photovoltaic solar cell, or also known as a photovoltaic cell. It's a device that converts the electricity by photovoltaic effect. So to sell something about that solar cell, when the engineer is making the solar cell, this will be small piece of solar cell, normally around 10 by 10 centimeter, and they are put into, called modules. So many cells are joined together in the module, and it can be connected by series to increase the voltage. It can be connected by parallel to add the current to the, entire module. And many such modules are joined together to create the solar array or photovoltaic array. That is what this picture. You can see many modules are there, and so many modules are connected together, so that the power is generated. So far, maximum around 100 megahertz power is generated normally through solar cell. beyond that, you know, cost involves more. This is
I am sorry to interrupt, but could you share your screen again? It isn't visible.
Oh, okay. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
How
and just a small request, Jagadish, Chenna, could you please switch off your camera? Thank you.
So you want me to switch off the camera?
No, sir. Another participant had their camera on. Not an issue.
So this is the solution given by a suggestion by an engineer, right? Little bit history about this is that the solar photovoltaic effect was invented in 1954, but very long back. I think I missed that one, but I see that the effect was solar cell was made in the 1954. Okay, but solar cell photovoltaic effect was introduced even before that one. But actually, from 54 to 82, this many years it took to make a photovoltaic based power generation, right? Actually making solar cell, right? So this is the photovoltaic effect, and you know very well that photons fall on the electrons and electrons are ejected and leaving the holes in this one. Yeah, see, now you can see that 1839, this effect was introduced or studied by a physicist, and 1954 only the photovoltaic cell was made. Even after that, first photovoltaic based solar cell created in California in 1982. Such a long time it took. Okay, so this is about that schematic explanation of how this is happening. So electrons are there, light is falling and ejecting electrons, and the electrons move out to the circuit, and holes are created. Okay, now I'll come to the science behind it. So that is the solution given by the engineer. Now, if you have that same engineer, okay, fine, solar cell, all these insults are fine, but how it is manufactured? How can you make the solar cell? No, they don't have any answer, because the metallurgy is coming from the chemistry, right? So, you know, this is silicon rods. Actually, this is from the production, this is how you get the silicon rods. So this is supposed to have this much purity. You see the last, this thing, and let me see whether the pointer is working. Yeah, you see this thing, 99.9999. So that much purity is required to use silicon in the solar cell. How will you make it? This is simple chemistry, what we read in this. This is not in the school book, it is in the college level book, BC level book, or sometime in MS level also. You see, silicon dioxide, which is basically major part of the sand, and it is reacted with the carbon, and silicon is produced, carbon dioxide is produced, this thing, at the temperature of 1900 degrees Celsius. Okay, and further reaction goes on, and then even more amount of the silicon is created here. So this is the chemistry which is really solving the requirement of engineer. And based on this chemistry, DuPont is one of the pioneering company in US. It was around a 150 year old company. So they produce this chemistry letter, and silicon tetrachloride react with zinc, and silicon is produced in this thing, and zinc chloride is the side product. But the purity, as I mentioned, 99.49, right? So that much purity, if you want to get it, that simply extracting the silicon from silicon dioxide is not sufficient. That's how these people, Siemens is another company, this is Siemens process, they have reacted silicon with the chlorine, hydrochlorosilane is produced, and thus hydrochlorosilane is distilled number of times in the high temperature, and that again it is reduced to get the silicon. Right. So that is how you get the pure thing. Another company, this is Renewable Energy Corporation. They are also produce a new technology, recent one actually. So they have done the silicon tetrachloride and reacting with the some impure silicon. And this is how this is obtained, and the hydrosilanes are created. These hydrosilanes are again decomposed to get the silicon. So much chemistry involved. Unless chemistry make this process, and nobody can use this thing for that purpose. Because I think I missed one. Yeah, this is one. And you see that EPBT, this is the energy payback time and cost factor involved in this process. So if you make a solar cell, and how much energy you are spending, you can see that I have used the 1200 or 1900 degrees Celsius to produce the material. How much energy we are going to spend to make the material, and how much time you have to wait to get back that energy from the solar cell. So it may take 4, 5, 6 years also to get that energy, what you spend. And then the normal lifetime of the solar cell is around 10 years only. So almost 50% of time we are waiting to get back the energy what we spend. After that, you are getting profit out of that, energy profit. Another thing is that cost factor. How much cost we are putting in to make the material, and then and from the energy, how much you can do the business. That is another problem. So that is creating trouble, though beautiful chemistry is developed, but still majority of the solar cell technology used in this world are based on silicon-based solar cells only, because so many processes are developed. But still people are doing to make varieties of other material also to make the solar cell. These are all the three generations of the solar cell I have shown here. But generation means that not based on the material, the time at which it came to the market, based on that. Okay, so early days all are based on silicon crystalline silicon solar cell. Later they developed thin film technology and make the silicon in the thin film form. And they use the solar cell. Apart from that, the lot of chemistry is developed, so people make the cadmium telluride, copper indium selenide, copper indium gallium selenide. This kind of solar materials are used in the solar cell. But the synthesis of this material is very important thing, how people make it and how we can fabricate the solar cell using this material. So that is where the chemistry is playing important role. And people are making this kind of flexible solar cell. It may look like fancy, but the usage is very high in that sense that people are trying to make the solar cell and just paint it on the wall so that the entire wall is becoming a solar cell, or window is becoming a solar cell, or the ceiling of the car or any automobile becomes a solar cell. So that kind of technology people are trying to develop, but based on simple chemistry. And we are also doing something, some research like this thing, making cadmium sulfate nanoparticles, and very, very many particles we have made in our laboratory in University of Hyderabad School of Chemistry. And we also just started making the solar cell out of this thing. This is just to tell about the overview of this thing, what is research direction. But basically, the take-home message is that how much chemistry is needed to make the solar cell. And when we are talking about entire global warming, all these things, you know, everything starts from the chemistry, right? And next topic is that, you know, pollution of vehicle. Same thing again, it is related to the solar cell, right? This is again, I have taken from the one of the textbook, the 11th class NCERT book. You can see that, no? Another picture is a cartoon from the internet site. The petrol cost day by day is increasing all over the world, right? It's nothing in our control. So petrol became a very big gift to the people. So that is how this cartoon is describing, but actually it is true, right? I think now it's around close to 90 rupees per liter, right? So, but even if you are ready to spend the money, the effect of this thing, petrol and diesel, into environment is really problematic. Again, the solution from the engineer is that you make a battery operated car, right? So this picture, what I'm showing is that these cars are known as Rewa car. why I'm showing that Rava car is this completely made in India, made in Bangalore, right? So this was initially introduced in around 2000 or 2001. Very small car, rarely you used to see here in Hyderabad, but it is, you know, you can see frequently in Bangalore. But this battery car has the problem. Anyway, I don't want to go to that, but this, the Rava company is purchased by the Mahindra now. Is called as a Mahindra Rava. Now they are introducing E2O, car name called E2O. And now there's, because the present government forced that now everybody has to go to electricity based car. So many companies are introducing. I know we are not going to that, those details. Basically, what the chemistry involved in this thing. These two pictures were just, you know, you can see the page number also, the textbook 321 and 271. So this chemistry is described in the school day textbook, and I don't know how many of you really understood the importance of this reaction. Partially, it is true that the teachers in the school level, they may not really tell that, they would have explained the chemistry, but they would not tell that, you know, the application of this chemistry. If you know the application of this thing, you will really appreciate and understanding, and you get interest to the science, right? So you see that this reaction, I don't want to explain all this reaction. Basically, this reaction shows how to make the silicone. Silicones are liquid inorganic polymers, not necessarily liquid. There are many solid polymer from the silicones also known. Silicone is common name given by CSIO bond. If there is FI1 bond in polymer, okay, this is called silicone. Sometimes people refer as silicone oil. So this is what described in the textbook, but we don't know what is the application of this thing. I'll come to this this right side figure little later. This you also know very well. This electrochemical series everybody explained to you. So the silicone oil, this is again really useful, is that these are all used as a lubricants, thermofuel. Thermofluid and hydraulic fluids, you know, lubricants. I'll just give one example. If you have a lubricant in a car runs in a earth only roads, right? But think about that flight which is going, you know, higher in the atmosphere level, temperature variation. So it may fly over north pole or south pole, or it may fly over desert also. If you go higher and higher, temperature will be decreasing, right? It goes to minus degrees Celsius. And if you land in desert, it will be 50 degrees Celsius, right? Minus 50 to plus 50 degrees Celsius. So much variation will be there in temperature. The lubricating oil, what we are using, supposed to maintain its lubricating property over a temperature range. If it is not melting, let us say it is going to the you know, higher atmosphere and freezing temperature, it get freezes. You know, you can imagine what kind of accident can happen, right? So that is where we are using the silicone oil. That is made by simple chemistry, what we learn in the laboratory. Another thing, you can see that one by one, the aerospace and space station. And satellites are there. So satellites are, when it is stationed at the higher atmosphere, they also move some of the part in the satellite. Satellite is moving in the atmosphere. That is different way. This is different technology. But the some part in this one, they move, and there are supposed to be some lubricant for this one. So that is what they think. And electrical insulator, transformers, all these things. So they use this kind of oil, right? So that is made by simple chemistry. So another chemistry what you learn in our textbook is that this is the electrochemical cells, are also known as a galvanic cells. So you can see any textbook that how to write the electrochemical cell, write the anode at the left side of, as you see, and write cathode at the right side, and reduction happen in cathode. People may explain that you remember using this terminology, red cat. So reduction in cathode. So if you know that red cat, so reduction in cathode, you can say that anode for oxidation. So all these things are explained to you in this school day. But this, how this chemical is coming, the cell manufacturer is coming, this is coming from our electrochemical series. So galvanic cell or voltaic cell is the one which is chemical energy is use and electrical energy is produced here. Whereas in the electrolytic cell, right? Electrolytic cell, the reverse of this thing. So we are forcing the reaction to happen in non-spontaneous direction. Basically, we are supplying current and chemical reactions happen here. So general name is electrochemical cell. Electrochemical cells includes both voltaic cell or electrolytic cell. So this is the what used in the batteries. Whereas this, just now I discussed you that in furnace, you use the carbon cathode electrode. This is the electrolytic cell used to manufacture many of the metal from in the earth. Whereas this galvanic cell is used in the batteries here. So in the textbook, you can see that this is a simple example. You put that one electrode, for example, copper in the copper sulfate solution and silver in the silver nitrate solution, and put a salt bridge and put a electric circuit, all these things, you can see that the current is produced, and then over a period of time, reaction is happening, and the current is slowly going and becomes zero. That means that reaction is over. Now we have to supply current from outside so that reaction can be reproduced, forced to go in opposite direction. This is the textbook explanation in this thing. So, but same thing when you make into, in the form like this thing, you get a battery. So electrochemical cells, you have combination of many cells called as a battery. But you can see that colloquially, if you have simple cell watch, what you use in the remote control or something like that, touch light or this thing, we call it as a cell because that is the only one electrode, one anode, one cathode, one set of electrodes only available. If it is a battery, you can see that so many anode cathodes are stacked together to make the battery. Okay, so then chemistry involved is the typical electrochemistry and electrochemical series what we studied in our school textbook, right? What is the important thing what we learned from that electrochemical series is that if you take, let me take this silver zinc battery, right? So what is the difference between the electrode potential of silver and zinc? That is what you are getting as a actual potential of a battery, right? So I'll just go back to this thing, and you can see the silver is 0.8 volt, right? And what is that zinc is that, you can see minus 0.76. So you put that one into this equation, what is that difference you are getting? That is what observer said, actual voltage of the battery, right? So that electrochemical series really help you to understand or construct the batteries for real-time application. So though the battery is made by engineers, the chemistry and how to construct the battery, everything come from the simple chemistry from us. So that many such research is going on. They are doing that for stacking the batteries together, basically electrodes together, and lithium batteries are produced. That is what we are using for laptop. Many of you may be attending this lecture using laptop or cell phone. Those things have this battery, and those batteries are made by lithium ion battery. Why lithium ion battery? As I told that lithium has the highest positive potential, reduction potential. It can be coupled with any of the other material so that the volt will be around 3.5 volt. So high voltage can be obtained, and lithium is lightweight element. And that is why these lithium batteries are very famous. Voltage is very high and weight also very less here. So that's why you are using. Coming to the chemistry, what we learned, apart from the electrochemistry described in the electrochemical series and other things, this is another picture shown in the textbook of the 11th class, diamond and graphite. And you would have learned that diamond structure is a tetrahedral structure of the carbon, all these things they have explained. Similarly, it is going for diamond goes for the sp3 hybridization, whereas graphite has the sp2 hybridization. It has layer structure. All these things are explained. I don't know how many of you know how this structure is related to lithium ion battery. So lithium ion battery, apart from that one, now you can see that lithium ion battery is used in the laptop, camera, mobile phone, spine cell, which is used for many purposes here, right? A kind cell and a video camera, everything. So chemistry, again, is like this thing. You can see that the graphite is used as anode. Lithium cobalt oxide is a cathode here. And the, if you look at the BSc level textbook, and you are all IMS students, and you are coming to the second year or third year of your course, teachers will be telling you the structure of this, layer structure of the compound. So basically, if you know the layer structure of this compound, and you can predict whether this compound can be used in the in a lithium ion battery, or not necessarily lithium ion battery. I showed you in the previous slide that so many batteries are possible. What is happening when you have charge discharge cycle? The lithium ion, which is in solution, they go to the positive electrode, and or it stays in the negative electrode. So when it is completely charged, these lithium ions are staying in the layer between the graphene sheet. Right? Graphite has a number of graphene sheets, and there is a space between the graphene sheets, right? That space supposed to be good enough to accommodate the lithium ion. So that is what we are learning in that structure. So only when you learn the structure, you can say that yes, this structure can be used for this compound, can be used for this particular ions. Lithium ion battery, sodium ion battery, or magnesium ion battery, many such things are coming, right? So that is the reason why people are using the graphite here. Similarly, for this positive electrode, you see that during discharge, the all the lithium ions are moving from this electrode, and they go and stay, occupy the space between this thing, right? So they form a structure within that layer area, okay? So this lithium is coming from the lithium cobalt oxide, but this lithium ion also again goes settle somewhere here. That's how these things are happening. So the learning of the structure in the school textbook is actually really extended to real-time application, what we are using every day, even this minute we are using that one, right? So that is how we have to understand the chemistry and take the idea of to the further level, okay? So this third or last topic for me is that the combustion reaction. This is also given in your textbook. People just, teacher will now just explain that, no, you just burn the methane and with oxygen, carbon dioxide is produced and it is releasing 890 kilojoules of energy. Similarly, you can take any other organic compound, you can see that, no, energy is released in this thing. Fine, yeah, this is done. So you can directly relate this chemistry to the petroleum products. Petrol is burned and then energy is produced and car is moving or automobile bus is moving or any automobile is moving, right? Internal combustion engines are working on based on this thing. That is one direct extrapolation to this thing. For something new, I want to tell you that, you know, because the petrol product usage is, you can really correlate. So similar combustion reaction with the hydrogen peroxide and hydrazine, this is called hydrazine, hydrogen peroxide and hydrazine. And when you do the reaction with this thing, it's a simple combustion reaction. You can, combustion reaction is a complete oxidation reaction. Combustion is the terminology used by the scientists, the technologists basically. But in chemistry, this is complete oxidation reaction. So this combustion reaction produces a nitrogen gas. Yeah, what is good about this reaction? This reaction releases this much of energy, okay? This much of energy. So this energy is taken by this nitrogen gas, and that temperature, this will be producing more than 1000 degrees Celsius temperature, and that temperature, this will be water, also will be the gas. So both this gas is taking that energy, and kinetic energy of this gas is increased too much, enormously, and if it is confined into a space, this is propelling the rocket. That is what, you know the Newton's third law, right? So the rocket propulsion, that's what happened here. I'll come to that a little later. So all of us are using the TV, mobile, all signal is coming from the satellite, right? So this satellite, how they are working, how they are launched there, and what is the chemistry involved in this thing? You know, you have the geostationary orbit in this, where the satellites are placed. Polar orbits are also known. Geostationary orbit is that, let us say, you have an INSAT satellite which is focusing to the earth. So this is focusing to the earth. I could not identify where India is here in this map. Whatever it is, okay. Let us take any country. Let us focus on this satellite. This is focusing on one particular country. Okay. So you can see that geostationary rocket means that Earth will be rotating from morning to evening. So the satellite also supposed to move along with this thing, so that it is focusing only to that particular country. If it is India, it should focus to the India only, so that the communication within India is possible here. And this satellite can communicate with other satellites also. That is different thing, right? The polar satellite means that in a polar orbit means that satellite will be moving in its, on its own direction, and this can be used only when it is focusing for India. But this is used for communication between different country, or also the spying with the different country, all other many purposes, weather report, all this thing. And low Earth orbit also possible. This is mainly used for weather report, something like that. So the chemistry, how it is, this thing is that the all the rockets are powered by the reaction. The reaction which I showed you, the hydrogen and hydrogen peroxide. That was the reaction used in 1964 by Russian scientists to propel the first rocket in this world. First rocket in this world is propelled using that reaction only, but still many of the rockets are used by that reaction. Propelled by that reaction. You see that I have shown that two sets of diagram. You can see vertical line here. Right side are called as the rockets. So you would hear that, right side is shown here is the missiles. Agni, Prithvi, mini missile. Now, just now we had a Republic Day parade. You would have seen that some of this directly also through video, TV. Right, the left side set of things are rocket, what we call as an insert satellite. It is carrying satellite, but GSLV rocket, PSLV rocket, many things they talk about. What is this different between these two is that actually technically called they are both are rockets only. In this rocket, if you keep a satellite at the top, we still call it as a rocket, but this rocket carries this satellite and launches in the orbit. Whatever I mentioned just now, geostationary orbit or polar orbit. Whereas these are all called as a missile, but basically these are also rocket technology only, but at the end of the head, right? So we have explosive material. So this packet is carrying the explosive material, goes to the enemy's target and attack that place. So basically that is different this thing. So different between the explosive material and the rocket, right? Similar compound is used here, but here we are confining everything in the three-dimensional area. So pressure is developed inside, kinetic energy is increased, it explodes. Whereas here we control the direction of the explosion, so that gas is coming out from the one direction, is propels the rocket. So chemistry is same. So long back, 1847, this scientist made the first such a compound which can be used as a in an explosive material. Whereas this Alfred Nobel, you know, Nobel Prize, right? So he is that Alfred Nobel who created that Nobel Prize. So he mixed this compound with the some of the material called diatomaceous earth, which is available in the seabed, right? So that mixed with that one, he made dynamite, and that dynamite industry gave him a lot of money, and used by the leaders of the world for World War I. And he got frustrated, and then he thought that my invention gone bad in negative direction. So I don't want to use this money, and created trust. And he said that this money should be used to encourage the constructive research. So all these stories are known. So similar such compounds, RDX, HMX, PETN, all these things are used in the explosive material. So what I want to convey is that the chemistry what we learned in our school textbook, combustion reaction, same combustion reaction is used by the scientists in DRDO. DRDO is Indian Defense Development Organization, Research Development Organization, or NASA, or any things in the world, right? They are also using same studies what we learned in our school textbook. Same chemistry, nothing beyond that one, right? So to explain that, yes, if you have this compound, if you burn this compound, we can create this much energy, and these compounds are, this is the actual molecule, and it when it is explored, it goes to the immediately to the elemental level and then comes back to the stable part of stable molecules, small molecules, which actually which are gases at the temperature what we are talking about, and they are used either as explosive or propellant power. So the chemistry is same, nothing beyond that one, right? But we don't really understand that. We have done this chemistry or practicals as a calculation in the school textbook, that heat of formation calculation, Hess law, right? So the same thing used, you can see that Hess law is really used here. Reaction can happen in various steps, but the energy involved in this reaction is same, right? So using same technology, they are calculating the heat of explosion. So they calculate the heat of decomposition of the reaction, and per mole, how much energy is released, this much energy is released. So this calculation we learn in this school book, but the same calculation is still used by all over world, right? By a scientist, the technologist, to predict that how much explosive material I have supposed to keep in a missile, or how much the propellant material I have to keep in the rocket to take it to atmosphere, out of the atmosphere, or take it to moon, or take it to Mars, whatever it is. Right? The chemistry is same here. So, again, we have studied that at STP, standard temperature pressure, the volume of the gas is 22 decimeter cube. Right? So this is the one still used by everywhere, that how much volume it produces, and how much gas, basically volume of gas is produced, so how much pressure it will generate. So then for particular size of the rocket, how much compound I am supposed to keep inside to have that effect what I want. So power index is another terminology. It may not be in school book, but basically TNT was the first such a compound used, that is taken as a picric acid. Picric acid was the first compound used for this purpose, and that is taken as a standard. With that one, the quantity of energy released, this previous time, this quantity of energy Q is here, and volume of gas produced by this equation and this power index. Based on power index, they can say this is good explosive or bad explosive, not bad explosive, or which is better comparison between the explosive is possible with this thing. So based on that, what is the application required, we can track the compound for particular use. That is the chemistry here. Little bit more about this thing, not only this organic compound, inorganic compound, exothermic reaction, what we learned, you can see that beryllium, boron, lithium, aluminium, magnesium, these are all the elements used in the propellant application. Basically, because they are producing so much of energy in the oxidation reaction, and highest is coming from in the element in preactive, highest is coming from beryllium, next is boron. Beryllium is toxic and availability in the earth is very less, so we don't want to go for beryllium. Next one is boron. Boron has little bit problem in sense that ignition of the boron required high pure oxygen. When it is going outside of the atmosphere, you don't have oxygen, you have to supply the oxygen or oxidizing agents, right? So ignition is very, very difficult. So people are still doing research, only little bit of boron only generally used. But third one is lithium. Lithium, you know very well, is a highly sensitive element. So that it creates so much trouble, while handling or constructing the racket. So we don't want to go for this. Aluminium, compared to all three elements, this is almost off from the first one. But that is the one use measure by any propellant anywhere. Okay, so because it's cheap and easy to handle, and they are using it very normally. Sometimes magnesium also used, but you can see energy different here. So basically, what is that happened? So chemist make the polymer here. This is called hydroxy terminated polybutadiene. So this polymer is used so that it actually holds so much of material inside, right? It 15% of aluminium and many other things are there. And aluminium is, this is burned, and the aluminium also oxidizing, and the energy is produced by aluminium, taken by the gas molecule produced by burning of this material, this polymer, right? So the rocket is propelled here. Okay. So finally, what I want to convey is that if you want to make this rocket and missiles by engineers, so many engineers involved here, right? So engineering is that making this casting, making electronic part, when to burn. You can see the previous slide. I can the rocket is head is here, but gas is coming from this direction. Igniter is here, so the start burn from this direction, not from here. It burn from the head, right? And pressure goes develops here, and it is the gas is coming out from this direction only. So if you ask me why it is like that, sir, I will say that it is a basic some engineering. Yeah, that is what engineering. We don't know really. I don't know really what is the reason why they burn it. But they say that I know a little bit, but I cannot explain to you right now. It will take time. Basically, it is trying to balance the rocket direction. Okay. So, but everything is done by engineer. But only when scientists produce the material, a chemist produces material in the laboratory, all are possible. Okay. If this is not done by a chemist, they don't have any material to try. If they want to improve the performance, we have to work for this thing. Scientists has to produce material, or chemistry has to produce material based on simple chemistry, what we discuss. So the engineering developed from that one. So engineering is basically applied science. So when science is moved to applied, so it is engineering. So just last slide is that about doctors. You know, this aspirin, salicylic acid synthesis, chemistry students, when they come to fourth semester, fourth year, this reaction will be given in your laboratory, right? How to produce aspirin, right? So what is that? The reaction scheme, all these instruments, you can see yourself, a very simple reaction. So only when chemist designs the reaction and produce this thing, doctor can use this injection. Amoxicillin is a tablet. Use many is a very, very, very common antibiotic, broad spectrum antibiotic. So antibiotic is given for many diseases by a doctor, but chemist only make this material. So ultimately, the take home message is that you cannot say scientist who is great. Scientists are science, engineers and doctors. That is what the question asked by people in your society to you, right? So you are an engineer, you are a doctor, you are good. It's not like that. I cannot say that you are a scientist, you are great, because I am a scientist, I cannot say I am a scientist, I am great. So actually, if you look at that, both are equally good. So, but it has to go, balancing act. So science and scientists producing materials and with the various principles from the chemistry, physics and mathematics, right? So, and engineers and doctors, they use for real-time application. If you produce a material and if the engineers are not able to use, there is no use in what we are producing. And engineers say that if they are great and if we are not producing material, they don't have material to use it. So now we can think about that. Basically, all are equally good, but all depends on how much time and effort you spend on understanding the chemistry. I'm a chemist, so I can explain based on chemistry. So any subject, chemistry or physics or mathematics or biology, whatever it is, right? So you spend your time understanding the subject with the thinking that how this can be really useful for day-to-day life. So you get attracted to any subject. So today I just convey everything based on the explanation from the chemistry. So same thing can be extended to other subject as well. So I again repeat that one. You read the subject with real understanding, with the idea of use of this subject, so you will enjoy your studies. Okay, so this is where I want to stop it. Thank you all for listening. I am ready to answer any queries if you have, if I know the answer also. Okay.
Thank you, sir. That was a very interesting and informative talk. Now we'll address the questions asked by the attendees.
Yeah.
First question. Are the electric cells and batteries a potential replacement or a temporary substitute, as it includes the usage of elements which are non-renewable?
Okay. Non-renewable in the sense that if you take the carbon-based material, carbon-based energy sources, all carbon is converted to the carbon dioxide. But again, it goes to the atmosphere and it may come back as a carbon in different way through plant or this thing. Okay. At the same time, if you use any material, any elements for the battery application, they are not going out of the earth. They are still in the earth only. Right? So this is again indirectly is also renewable, but which is good in sense that carbon-based material creates the pollution is not good for the atmosphere. Whereas the other elements based on solar cell and battery, they are still going to be in the earth only and they are not producing the pollution. So that way elements are better than carbon-based fuels.
Okay, so like in respective view of the damaged environment, the other elements actually prove beneficial.
Yeah, I'm not getting your question again.
So like since carbon has a higher harmful effects on environment, so other elements prove to be effective in the renewable part?
I cannot say all the elements. If you take the cadmium based batteries, right, they are not good because cadmium is toxic. Okay, so we have to really think case by case. Wherever possible, go for stable element like copper and zinc based material or nickel based material which are not toxic for day-to-day life use. Lithium is not toxic, though it's sensitive to handle, but it's not toxic. So that will be very good. But some cases we are not able to really replace the carbon sources, right? So that is, we have to minimize the carbon based material because after some time, everything carbon based fuel is coming from the earth crust through petroleum crude oil, right? Petroleum products. So that is also depleting another 100 years probably almost all the petrol crude oil in the earth is to be used. So then we don't have any other option. We have to go for this thing. So it's supposed to be balancing act.
Okay, sir. Next question.
Yeah.
Is it possible that the behavior of the material which is being used at the lab level, like in gram levels, will have different properties at practical application levels, maybe in kgs and tons?
No, property of the material doesn't change. If copper has the reduction potential, whether you use 1 gram or you use 1 ton, reduction potential of the copper is not going to change. So quantity will not affect the material property, but the quantity will affect your determining capability. If you have sufficient material, you can measure the property accurately, but quantity of material very small, then the property will measurement may go for wrong, but depends on what method we are using to measure the property. But quantity doesn't affect the property.
Okay, sir, I hope that answers the question. And next question.
Yeah.
Nuclear chemistry is very, very dangerous for environment. Will you support nuclear chemistry?
Frankly, I would say no. The reason is that, yes, nuclear chemistry gives so much energy in a shorter time and the cost involved also relatively lesser. And you use very small quantity of uranium or thorium and you can have so much energy produced. But at the end, you know how we are going to dispose that enriched uranium and thorium. But you see that uranium and thorium is coming from earth only. But we are just modifying and enriching that and then we are dumping back to here, but we cannot dump back in the same place where you got it. So you have to put it to deep inside the air and handling will be a problem. If we have, basically this is used for energy source. If we can use simple stable material, like safer material like silicon or copper based solar cells, right? Copper induced sulfate based solar cell or cadmium telluride based solar cell. Why do you want to go for nuclear energy? So my suggestion would be that we have to focus completely based on solar energy based materials. So that will be definitely replacing any other things like carbon based or nuclear based. So I would say no to the nuclear industry.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
If anyone has any questions, they could unmute themselves and ask the question.
Okay, somebody is asking that what is the reason for solar cell, what exactly reason why the efficiency is not going up? Yeah, it's a good question. So this solar cell works based on the principles of photovoltaic effect. The photovoltaic effect defined by, again, controlled by the band gap. Band gap is basically you have material, semiconductive material like silicon, and when bonds are formed within all the silicon atoms are there, silicon you are seeing, but in that one millions of atoms will be there, right? So there will be a bonding between the atoms. When they bonding between atoms, the orbitals are overlapping, so it creates valence band and conduction band. So difference between valence band and conduction band, which is defining factor for the photovoltaic effect. Okay, so if conduction band of silicon is something around 1.13 electron volt, so that is good enough for the electron photon to fall on, excite the electron, and circuit is happening here. That is defined by the nature. So when silicons are joined together, difference between valence band conduction band is produced. That is defined by nature. So with that one, maximum 33% efficiency. I mean, I don't remember exactly, around 33% efficiency is possible in silicon. That means that if 100 photons are falling onto silicon, only 33 electrons can be ejected from the silicon. So I was not technical word, but colloquially I'm just explaining for easy way. Like something like that. So then efficiency now controlled by this material property. The material property is nature. We cannot change it. So we cannot go beyond that one. So we can alter that conduction band and valence band different between these two by modifying the silicon. That's why the cadmium tellurate, right? So this kind of material that people are using. So combination of elements are made, compounds are made, right? So we can alter the valence band, conduction band. But if you take that single element, we cannot change it. So when even if you mix 2, 3, 4 elements together, what is that happening? That is not in our control. Basically, it's again natural thing, right? So that is one of the reason for efficiency drop. So within that 33% efficiency, as I told, energy payback time and cost factor. So is it okay? That is what the thing we are controlling. That's why we are not able to achieve completely its solution. But of course, the more and more research in engineering helps to make the solar cell in a better way. And many chemists also producing, or material chemists are producing many new material. Things are far better than early days now. Any question?
Anyone could unmute themselves if they have a question and ask the question.
Hello, sir. Good morning. This is Aditi from IMSC Chemistry.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So since right from the beginning, you were like addressing the conflict which people have of choosing the field of in engineering or medicine sciences or becoming a scientist. So yeah. This is the first talk from you for GSC. So we would like to know your journey and your pathway of discovering what career you chose in your life.
Okay, good question. Okay, I told you when I explained that engineer, doctor, all these things that based on rank, mark, all these things, partially true. It actually really true for my case actually. I did not score sufficient mark initially to get into engineering course, though my parents are suggesting me, right? My brothers got engineering course, and then they admitted to that one. My father was telling that I should also go for that one. But you know, there are two things. One is that I did not get the mark sufficiently that time, that is true. At the same time, my mind was not really onto that one, engineering side. So I just selected to go for BSc Chemistry. And I, after BSc Chemistry, I slowly went into the research interest and captured to that area. So I went to MSc and then I pursued to PhD. Right. So once you come to even MSc level, when you start do some reactions in laboratory and project in your laboratory, I did my project in battery electrochemistry in the Central Electrochemical Research Institute. Okay. So then I got naturally attracted to this thing, and then I just moved to the research and carried this thing. But I've been telling, but it's maybe my case was based on that moment, based on Mark. But I know many other my friends those days itself, they prefer to go for science and skipping the engineering admission. I know recently somebody, even they got the IIT admission, they skipped that IIT BTEC admission, and they skipped it and went for IMSC physics in TAFR. Okay, so that shows that people are really interested in science. This is how I started my interest to the science. Once I moved into science, I got more interest. After MSc, if there was a chance to go to BTEC, I would not have done. That is my career.
Yeah, I think, sir, a lot of us can relate to it. Maybe a lot of students are in our batch must have tried for engineering, then skipped to this. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. See, that's why, again and again, actually, I choose this topic because 2 years back, or maybe that boy may be still there in your class or MSc, you're just senior, maybe, or 2 years senior to you. I don't know the name. He was very much interested to go for doctor, and he was telling that sir, my brothers are doctor, my parents are telling that to go for medicine, right? So, and he was frustrated, he was not concentrating on any laboratory course. One day I called, I spoke to him like this thing for half an hour, and I hope I convinced him. I convinced him to continue IMSc because you tried 1 year and then you could not get it. Second year also you tried, you could not get it. Why are you only thinking about that? So why life is not only based on engineering, life is not only based on doctor, right? So scientists also can do very good things, right? So I conveyed this message to him. I hope he is very happy now, I guess so. Right. So that is time I always think that when students are coming, you are chosen to, or you have chosen to write the exam for engineering division. I don't know how many of you really say that, yes, this is what my interest. I went for that one. I think 50% people may not say that this is what my father told, my mother told, my brother told, my sister told, my uncle told. This is what I will answer from the 50% of students, definitely. So because they are not really know what they are interested. And then because of society, everybody feel that this is good, everybody will go for that one. So that should change. That attitude should change. Even if I'm trying for that one, definitely one thing I should convey that if you go for engineering, getting job will be faster than science direction. Getting job will be faster, and you may earn money quickly compared to science field. That is truth. Okay, that is the problem in India only. But if you go to developed country like US or Germany, no, it's not true. So everybody is getting job equally good or equally bad. In fact, present day scenario in India, many people are losing job in engineering stream, whereas all chemists are gaining job. You know, the pandemic time, almost all engineering working software company, they had fear whether I'll be retaining job or not because of layoff. But no one in the chemistry industry is having fear because everything depends on chemistry industry now, or biological based industry. As is supposed to produce by biological scientists, and the chemist has to make the material for chemicals required for the making vaccine or chemical required for medicines, right? So everything, this industry is flourishing well now compared to engineering-based industries, right? So then, which is good. So don't worry about that one. You have chosen to join this thing. Nothing wrong in this one. Do it very happily. That's my suggestion.
Thank you so much, sir. I think someone had to say that. My father is sitting right next to me, and I had myself chosen something out of the pop to medical careers and engineering careers. So it seems my father is happy right now, and I am happy too. Thank you so much.
Yeah, fantastic. I am very happy that at least one guy is very happy because I'm my sister. And I thank you, concerned father, that no, you understood that one. And you know, I don't know the boy or girl, so she has chosen good direction only, nothing wrong this way.
Thank you.
There is another question: why theoretical chemistry is taught in India more than practical chemistry? Yeah, this is the interesting question. Basically, I would say with the first answer is that money. Okay, entire chemistry, what we discuss in our laboratory, the theory classes can be shown as a demonstration in the lab. But how much money involved? You guys just joined and you did not have chance to do practicals in chemistry lab, right? Physical chemistry practically only started now. So a lot of money is involved in buying chemical. You will have qualitative analysis lab. I will be coming for that lab. All of you, right? So much money involved. For example, earlier 5-6 years back, we used to purchase silver nitrate, 100 gram of silver nitrate, 13,000, and it is given 1 gram for all students. And then that day, that 13,000 is gone. Everything qualitative analysis is done, and the chemical is gone. Right. So then later we realized that it's not viable, so we stopped the silver nitrate experiment. We went for copper-based, zinc-based, cheaper experiment so that we can go for 3-4 experiment. Because funding availability is, let us say, funding given to AMS lab is around 1 lakh per semester. So I have to use that 1 lakh to buy all the chemicals. So a lot of cost involved. Apart from that, theory, you should know some theory like Newton's law. Only we understand Newton's law, we can show the practical. So we should understanding theory first, then we have to go for practical. So this is my answer to question from Pranay.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, I have one question, which is, in general, like one enters science expecting or hoping that his or her research would be like more of a practical, useful for the practical world and like can bring some changes in the world. But sometimes we also hear stories like many people's research is just not that. I mean, it's into so depth that it might not be practically directly applicable to many things. Like, I hope you are getting that, what I mean to say.
I know.
How does one has to approach science in sense like, how does one have to face in reality that your research or one's research might not be completely like this and like, how to get over it and how to approach, how to look at science in a real way?
Yeah, it's good you ask this question. I just showed you the 1838 photovoltaic effect was described, right, and invented. 1954 is the one where they first did solar cell. So it took 70-80 years, right? And then 1994, electricity manufacturing plant was introduced. So that 30 years only. And similarly, coming to the present situation of COVID, so when the pandemic happened 100 years back, they took 5 to 10 years to make the vaccine. But now, within 1 year, at least some vaccine is introduced in all our world. So the time is changing and involves a lot of money. Right, so we're not able to do every day. Today I do experiment and tomorrow it will be used. If a scientist think like that is wrong direction. Okay, so the science is the one we are producing. We find the application at any time. It may be in 1 year, it may be after 100 years or so. That is one thing. And the another thing is that all PhD students, I've been getting, or everybody I used to tell that, no? PhD is the one, the course, PhD course is the one where you get to learn how to do research. right? So in MSc you learn many sciences, right? Chemistry, physics, all this, basically, and a little bit of practical, how to do experiment. That is what the practical idea of the practical in the BSc MSc level. So you know how to handle the chemical, how to use the instruments, and that is extended out to PhD. And in PhD, not only handling the chemicals, instrument, you learn how to do research. What is mean by research? How to do research. That's a training you get it. So when you go with that training to job, then only the real application comes. Okay. So it's not that I did PhD, I made compound, it will be used immediately. That is very, very, very rare. One thing I can tell you that, no, we are doing one research based on the DRDO project, borane-based compound. So that now we produce the compound, and that compound is taken by the DRDO scientists. They are going to make in 1 kilo, and they want to test this test level record. So that is the one thing. That this kind of thing happened very rarely, but I'm just telling one compound, I did it. But to make that design that compound, almost 8 years we have taken. Now it has come to 1 kilo level synthesis and real time testing. So it's not that every compound will be, or every material what we are making will be used immediately. It will find out application later, but basically you are getting training and learning how to do research.
Thank you, sir. It was really nice to know your journey, and I received a very wonderful message through it.
If you
have any other questions, please unmute yourself and ask the question, or you can drop it in the chat box. If there are no questions, I think we can end the session. Thank you, sir, for addressing all the questions.
Thank you very much.
The recording of this talk will be uploaded on our YouTube channel. You can also follow us on Facebook and Instagram for more updates. Now, I would like to conclude this session by thanking our honorable speaker on behalf of JSC. I thank Professor Sanjay Subodh, Director of CIS, and Professor Krishnaveni Mishra for providing us this opportunity. I am grateful to all the faculty coordinators for their constant support and guidance. I would also like to thank all the JSC coordinators, without whom this talk wouldn't be successful. At last, I extend my thanks to all the audience. Thank you for making this talk successful.
Thank you all. All the best to all. We'll meet in the lab maybe next week.
Thank you, sir.
I shall be stopping the recording now. I thank you everyone for joining for the talk. Stay tuned for more such talks in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. I'm leaving.